How do you think it's changed then, your role as CEO, going from privately held to publicly listed Arm? How has it changed your role?
We've been public now for a few months.
Yeah.
So I would say I feel like the eyes are upon me a little bit more than they were prior. But on the other hand, I try to think about it in terms of the future of Arm is really not measured in what we are today. It's what we're going to be in a few years.
And how do you balance the demands of investors in the company now, those new investors and the legacy investors, and of course Masayoshi Son, SoftBank being the big force, gravitational force there? How do you balance those demands?
So Arm is really a company that is hard to look at quarter to quarter, because the technology we're working on today is really technology that's going to end up in products 3 years from now, 4 years from now. So while the financial results are important, they're really the results of strategies we put in place a number of years ago, which were quite successful. So what we try to do is just make sure that the investors understand that while the near-term results are very important, it's really also important to really think about the long term and where we're going directionally.
Look, Arm was set up in the 1990s. You've been the building blocks of our digital globe, digital world, digital economy since then. And now we're at this point where we're focused on generative AI, and that is reshaping this digital ecosystem that we now live in, or that we will be living on. What role do you see Arm playing in that transformed digital space in the years ahead?
Yeah, so Arm in the 30 plus years has just been foundational to computing in a way that no other computer architecture before it, and I dare say after it, has been. 70% of the world's population touches Arm today in some way. We were well known for smartphones, and before that, non-smartphones, feature phones, if you will. The Arm of today is not only much more diversified around, as I mentioned before, data centers, automotive, IoT, but now as AI and AI workloads are finding their way into every single application, whether it's your thermostat or your data center, Arm will be there. So I think for us in the upcoming years and decades, Arm will be foundational to everything going on with AI.
So you can assure investors that you will remain, you're essential right now to this digital world that we live in. You will be essential in that generative AI reshaped world in the years ahead. You will continue to play that essential role.
You can't run AI without Arm. It's foundational. And AI is going to find its way into every single electronics device that we use. Again, whether it's the smallest device in your home or the largest data center that sits out in the wild.
Every AI executive that I speak to, whether it's DeepMind or Cohere or Inflection or others, say the scramble for compute is front and center, along with the fight for talent. How do you see that fight for compute going forward?
I do think for the next number of years, we are going to see a increasing demand for more and more compute. Now, I think what's also going to drive is a high degree of need for power efficiency, because these data centers require hundreds of watts, megawatts, up to the gigawatts of type of energy. We don't produce that much energy as a planet. We are having limitations relative to fossil fuels, limitations to sustainable. So a rush to get to power efficiency around these compute models is going to be very, very significant. That's great for Arm, because the DNA of our company is around power efficiency.
I want to go back to 2017. You diversified the business. You broke out these four different divisions, IoT, cloud, infrastructure, autonomous vehicles. Why did you see that as necessary?
Previous to 2017, we would design a mobile processor and then really attempt to squeeze it or peanut butter it, if you will, into the server space or into the automotive space or into different areas of IoT. It just wasn't sufficient. And we had a lot of questions early on. Well, what's taking Arm so long to be successful in the servers? Many different reasons contributed to that. But one of them was, candidly, we just didn't have the right products. And we were able to create Neoverse. We were able to add custom extensions, things like confidential compute, that are necessary for building high-grade data centers. We could put those in the products. And now with Neoverse, we have a world-class competitive entry that you're seeing the benefits of it, whether it's the Microsoft Cobalt or AWS. We had to do that in 2017 because it was clear that these other markets were demanding it and the software ecosystem needed to be able to support it.
What kind of revenue mix would you need to see to kind of declare a success in that diversification push?
I'm going to declare some modicum of success now. We were over 60% revenue in smartphones, maybe even higher. Prior to this change, smartphones now, while a very large market for us, are about 40% and declining. And our largest growth in terms of revenue are coming from these new markets, as I mentioned, cloud and automotive.
Which of those is most exciting to you? Cloud, automotive, which has the greatest prospect in terms of driving revenues into the business?
I do think the cloud data center is even potentially more exciting from the perspective of when you layer in the AI component. We talked about all the growth that Arm has seen in the cloud, but now as we're seeing the shift towards AI, a product like Grace Hopper, again, NVIDIA taking their GPU and our CPU and creating the world's best super chip for AI, that wasn't, you know, on the roadmap in 2017 when we started because we weren't thinking about the AI market. So I think for us, cloud could be a terrific opportunity.
What is the market share in cloud that you would be targeting in the years ahead? Do you have a number in mind, Rene?
You know, we're in double digits now.
Yeah.
And I always like to say when you get to double digits in our space, you're now in the party.
Mm-hmm.
Can we get to over 50% over time? I think we can.
I want to talk a little bit about Arm's place in the UK. Arm was conceived, of course, here in Cambridge in the UK. It's now obviously majority owned by a Japanese company, SoftBank, listed in the US. What role do you see the UK playing for Arm in the years ahead?
The UK is our home. It's our headquarters. It's where we were born, and we're always going to be here. So the UK is incredibly central to the future of Arm in so many ways. Probably our biggest bottleneck for growth is just getting talent in. But we are very, very committed to the UK. And again, the UK is going to be so critical for our future.
And the Prime Minister, the Chancellor, they want to turn the UK into the next Silicon Valley. Is that realistic, Rene? Really?
There's only one Silicon Valley, right? Mm. It's a unique area in terms of its ecosystem, the universities, and how the whole section works. Does that mean that can't be imitated or replicated on some level in other parts of the world? No, not at all. And I think the government here has been doing a fantastic job around that. And Cambridge itself is a very, very rich community of small companies, incubators, the universities.
What would you say to any incoming government, whether it's the Conservative government or a Labour Party government, that you would want to see happen in those first 100 days?
We're very committed to the UK. This is our home. We were born here. We intend to stay here. Please make it very easy for us to attract world-class talent and attract engineers to come work for Arm, because that is the single largest limiter that we will have for growth. Is access to talent. And if that gets any more difficult with a change in government that you described with the next election, that would be a headwind I would not want to have to engage on.